Hello and welcome to this very special show that we are having on an topic, on an issue that's been very hotly contested and has been a matter of, well, a lot of literature as well in the entire subcontinent, that is the India-Pak relations. Today, USI is putting forth this very interesting conversation with two scholars, and it's my privilege to welcome both of them. I'm Gauri Dwivedi. I need a detailed introduction as well. I'm Gauri Dwivedi. I'm a visiting fellow at USI. The two gentlemen joining me do not need an introduction. They're both scholars of their fields. M.J. Akbar, he's a member of parliament from Rajya Sabha, from the ruling dispensation, and an author of a dozen odd books and understands this region very, very closely. Also on the show is Professor Ishtiaq Ahmed. He's a Swedish political scientist and author of Pakistani descent and holds a PhD in political science. And he's a professor emeritus of political science at Stockholm University. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining me in this conversation.
Thank you very much. I'm great.
Thank you, Gauri.
Yeah.
So we'll try and take this a little forward from the recent set of developments that have taken place. A lot has happened, from the ceasefire to General Bajwa's comments, where, believe it or not, he didn't mention 370 abrogation. And then, of course, Imran Khan, as the Prime Minister, rejecting the decision that he himself took as the Commerce Minister. So in the midst of all this, you know, Mr. Akbar, let me start with you. You are from the BJP, you understand this area very well, the entire thinking behind the Pakistani establishment. I want to ask you this, that every time one talks about two steps forward with Pakistan, it's three steps backward as well. No matter how far back in time we go, Lahore Declaration or even before that, but how do we now try and address this issue? Can we at any point look to move forward from the contestation that we've had for so long to anywhere close to cooperation?
It's a very, you know, it's a very simple answer. It's a very simple question with a very difficult answer, because the fundamental problem with any proposal to move forward in Indo-Pak relations is that, you know, Pakistan's insistence that there cannot be any serious movement forward without a solution to what in the Pakistan matrix is essentially an insoluble matter, which is the conflict over Jammu and Kashmir. The history of our relationships from the Nehru-Liaquat Pact forward, I would go before that. You know, I think a little perspective is important here. When partition happened, 15th August 1947, Jammu and Kashmir, as everyone knows, had not acceded to either union, and it is a very, very cogent view that of the three countries, of the three nations at the moment involved in the decision on the future of the old. To recognize Britain, India, and Pakistan, I think nobody would have accepted the Kashmir as an independent entity, and therefore a peaceful discussion on what would be the way forward vis-a-vis Jammu and Kashmir would eventually have taken place. And according to a note sent by Jawaharlal Nehru to Mountbatten, I think he had proposed a discussion on this subject after the spring thaw of 1948. Do remember that in August 1947, both sides were overwhelmed with the humanitarian crisis of refugees, the inability to get alternative governments in place, and so on and so forth. Unfortunately, what could have resulted in a peaceful resolution or a resolution through dialogue was sabotaged completely by Pakistan's decision within 10 weeks of freedom to try and seize Kashmir by war rather than through a dialogue. Since then, the temptation to conflict, unfortunately, has always managed to destroy any chance of a peaceful bilateral relationship on the subject. I mean, 47 went off. Really, the next efforts at peace came when Sheikh Saab was sent, Sheikh Abdullah was sent by Jawaharlal Nehru in 1964 to Karachi. Shastriji also stopped by in Karachi on his way back from Cairo after he became prime minister. And there was the famous, whichever adjective you'd like to use, talks, six rounds of talks between Zulfikar Ali Bhutto and Sardar Swaran Singh. And each effort really was destroyed by the conflagration of war, the 1965 war, which again was a blatant act of aggression by Pakistan. Since then, it has been, I think from our side, you know, we have become increasingly, party neutral on the subject, because Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee went and through and in Lahore reassured, as far as anyone could, Pakistan, that India had absolutely no motives and respected the integrity of Pakistan and so on. And the best way forward would obviously be through a dialogue, a totally bilateral dialogue on Kashmir. This too, again, was destroyed successively by what has been called, judiciously, war by other means, and in our terminology, by terrorism. The Agra Pact was actually, didn't come to any fruition because of inability of Pervez, President Musharraf, to accept that terrorism was happening and indeed continues to happen. It's very difficult, you know, to have a dialogue, you know.
Yes.
Talk about peace without an environment of peace. I mean, sulah ki baat hogi jab aman ki baat hogi jab aman hoga.
Right.
And if there is no peace, then this dialogue becomes totally. I think our present Prime Minister also made very significant efforts. You will recall that he invited President Nawaz Sharif along with other SAARC countries to his first inauguration. He even actually made the dramatic sort of stopover in Lahore on his way back from Afghanistan in an effort to take forward the peace process. But over and over again, SAARC, violent, audacious and completely unacceptable acts of terrorism have sabotaged this effort. We have reached a point today where once again, you know, today optimism really seems to be taking a step too far forward. All optimism, you know, you tend to trip over optimism. And this again seems to be happening. A very few signs, a very, very faint signs of some positive movement had begun to appear in the atmosphere. And suddenly we have a statement by the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Imran Khan, that, you know, the abrogation of 370, and unless conditions don't work, you have to accept that what is happening, that the Article 370, even when it was instituted, when it was passed by India's parliament, it was very clearly said it's a temporary measure. And temporary is a word whose meaning can easily be recognized by even the briefest look at any dictionary. So a temporary measure was brought to an end. And in any case, the status of Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir, is an internal matter of India. And I think it is important to accept that reality, and then we can have. There is so much to be gained out of peace, and so little to be purchased from conflict. that, I mean, you don't need to be a genius to recognize that. Common sense tells you that.
Exactly.
Particularly, if I may take a minute more, I think the dream scenario, you know, we think of one partition of India, which is 1947. But really, it was the consequences of the 1965 war, which have had a much bigger impact. Because before 1965, travel was far easier, far, far easier. There was trade, you know, industrialists on both sides had, at least Indian industries, certainly DCM and so on, had investments in Pakistan, newspapers and so on, all used to come. There was a sense of normalcy. But after the 65 war, a heavy wall, a psychological wall came down, and that psychological wall really has become virtually impenetrable space now.
Professor Ishtiaq Ahmed, then let me bring you in, sir, that if this is how things stand, and you know, as Mr. Akbar said, that you can't have conditions over even, you know, beginning of some sort of a dialogue, forget a long-term peace process, then are we correct to assume that even baby steps right now, I mean, resumption of trade and cricket ties are really baby steps, you know, we're not even looking at the contentious issues. Even they seem to be now pretty much off the table right now.
Well, the thing is that I have studied the Kashmir dispute in at least three books. One was State, Nation, and Ethnicity in Contemporary South Asia. The second one is Pakistan, the Garrison State, and now my latest book on Jinnah. And I happen to agree with Mr. M.J. Akbar completely. I'm one Pakistani. I mean, I don't find myself comfortable being presented here as a of Pakistani descent, unless you want me to assume Pakistan's, you know, take cudgels on behalf of the Pakistan state. I don't think that's my duty, and that's not how I see it either. We are all agreed, and I've said over and over and over again, in all these wars that you have launched to liberate Kashmir, not an inch has been won for Pakistan. So any realism, any understanding of the situation based on facts would make a rational state turn corner and look at another alternative. And I think history seems to have decided that the line of control is the international border for all practical reasons between Pakistan and India. And as soon as Pakistan has the courage to accept this, that what the Indian government has done in Kashmir is, of course, a question where Indians are disputing it, and let them do it. Whether this, removal of the Article 370 was constitutional or not, this is being discussed in the Supreme Court and in the public forums and all. This is for India to decide. As long as India does not step into the Pakistani Kashmir, I think Pakistan has no right to put up conditions regarding Indian policy on Kashmir. This is for the Indian people to decide whether this action of the Indian government was acceptable or not. And as we have been told, there was an election, there was a manifesto, and the majority voted for this sort of integration of the Kashmir state, now union territory, and so on. But obviously, it's a question of how the Kashmiris are taking it. Are they resisting it? Are they accepting it? The Indian government has to prove that it is carrying the people with it. Regarding Pakistan, the sooner the better that they accept that the line of control is the international border. Let me try to explain it with another example. On our western border, there is the Durand Line, which Pakistan wants to be converted into an international border. So when I say convert borders into bona fide de jure international borders, this is also Pakistan's position, but vis-a-vis Afghanistan. And Afghanistan doesn't agree that the line, that the Durand line was the should be the international border. They have claims on Pakistan. But all these are part of a colonial period when borders were drawn arbitrarily, these lines were drawn arbitrarily. All I know is that war has not won Pakistan an inch of Kashmir. And in the next hundreds of years, this is not going to happen. So I think the only way to move forward is, you know, I've written at one stage that there is a comparable problem of the Åland islands between Finland and Sweden. The islands are occupied entirely by Swedish-speaking people. Huh? But during the Russian-Swedish War in the 18th century, the Åland islands were taken over by the Russians. Later came the Russian Revolution, and Finland was given freedom. And then Finland did not want to give the Åland islands to Sweden, even when the total population was Swedish. So this was taken to the League of Nations, and the League of Nations gave a ruling that Finnish sovereignty is legal. On the other hand, Kashmir should be demilitarized. So neither Finland nor Sweden should have any military ambitions on these islands. Now, of course, after the integration of Kashmir by the Indian government, the situation has gone even further, because I wrote this in 2002, that it doesn't really matter whether the people of the Kashmir Valley, you know, Jammu doesn't want to join, Ladakh has no interest. It's only the Muslims of the Kashmir Valley who probably would like to join Pakistan or be independent. But that can't be done. There are all these rivers on which the upper riparian has the upper hand, and that has worked very well insofar as Pakistan's claim on the waters of the rivers. So India has kept its promises. It is the more dependable, reliable, responsible state. Saying this gains me all the wrath of my compatriots, but that doesn't matter. It's too late in the day now to become a petty nationalist and discuss with Mr. Akbar, who I respect very deeply. And we believe in freedom, and the only way forward is accept the line of control as the international border. And as Manmohan Singh and Musharraf and my friend Foreign Minister Khurshid Mahmood Kasuri had prepared this plan, you know, that it will become the international border, and in the next 15 years people can discuss and so on. I mean, that was only done to facilitate it. The thing is that it is now, it should be the international border, but with this proviso that Kashmiri people should have the right freely to travel on both sides, while both states can claim sovereignty over their portions of Kashmir. And that's the best solution for the Kashmiris. We want the same to be done in Punjab, actually. Why just Kashmir? The Punjab was torn in the middle on the religious basis also, you know. We want an end to that even. But let's start with Kashmir, and let's prove that once you have relaxed borders and you build trust, there is no need to renegotiate the borders between India and Pakistan. The line of control is the historical international border de facto. I say make it de jure and bring to an end this whole fixation with Kashmir. Now, the problem is that if from day one, for all these years, you have been telling the Pakistani people that Kashmir is inseparable, inextricable from the identity of Pakistan, then you see this zigzag happening. You know, General Bajwa has the courage to say this. Imran Khan, the populist, goes, you know, one of his ministers has even proposes free trade, you know, Pakistan importing cotton and sugar. The next day, the cabinet overrules it. This is immature. This is self-defeating. The Pakistan cabinet has become a joke. And I have been a critic of all this for too long now. I find my arguments being borrowed even by mainstream journalists and writers. It's a pity they don't recognize that I'm the original source of all these arguments in all these books and consistently. And some of my articles were published by Akbar Saab in this newspaper as well. So my position has been consistent. One day, the solution I propose, it's fair, it is realistic, and it gets good dividends to India, Pakistan, and the Kashmiris.
All right. But thank you so much then for that clarity. But then, you know, Mr. Akbar, the point is, if one says that to be able to accept the LOC as international border would be, you know, something that the Pakistani army cannot do because it robs them of their institutional legitimacy. The same argument can then be extended for parts of, the ruling dispensation as well, because, you know, BJP's stand has been that, you know, we have to also take back PUK, Akhand Bharat, the whole argument there. So then how do we move forward then? We're back to square one essentially.
Well, first, let me thank Professor Ishtiaq Ahmed for the very kind things he said about me personally. I'm very deeply grateful. Coming from you, sir, is a privilege. The essential beauty of the proposal that has been advocated by Dr. Ahmed and some of his colleagues and has been discussed, as we all know, in great detail, under the radar, if not on the radar, during the Vajpayee years, and perhaps also after the Vajpayee years during the Dr. Manmohan Singh years.
Yes.
I've often thought of the meaning of a word that we use all the time, and I'm sure even this brief period of 15 minutes or so, we must have used it half a dozen times. How do you solve the Kashmir problem? The word solve is a very interesting word. I hope you understand its philology. Solve comes from a solution. A solution is liquid. A solution is not hard. Once we keep in mind that a process can also be a solution, then we have moved somewhere closer towards, you know, finding something that could become mutually acceptable. You know, hard things like war have frozen the subcontinent.
Yes.
Now we need the warmth of a thaw, of a solution. Snow comes, suddenly we'll build up a snowstorm, block all the valleys. But a thaw comes slowly. A thaw comes through process. So what Kasturi Saab and others were actually, not him alone, I'm sure you will agree, Professor Saab, alone, were saying, give ourselves a 15-year thaw and let experience of this thaw, let the experience of a normal relationship between two nations, and they are two nations and, you know, they will remain two nations. Let the experience of this bring home to the people the enormous unlocked value of friendship. Today, we've actually put the friendship between two peoples into some God knows Pandora's box and thrown away the key. Let us, now while we are discussing, and Professor Saab mentioned, took a brief comparison with Afghanistan and the Durand Line. Let me travel across from Attari and go to Benapole, to the Indo-Bangladesh border. Till 1971, what is today Bangladesh was East Pakistan. And because of conflict, relationships had, after 65, frozen. Now, you do realize that thanks to colonial history, in which people kept, you know, just sketched out lines, we have border issues with, not with only with Pakistan, we have it with China, and we used to have it with Bangladesh. Bangladesh today, out of the thaw of friendship, good relations, movement between people, people-to-people relations, there came a time when the Parliament of India unanimously, all the parties accepted a solution on the Indo-Bangladesh border, in which actually, if you go by the strange logic of square inches, we must have handed over more territory to them than they gave to us. But it didn't matter, because it was a solution which actually enhanced and actually released the whole of the East. Today, we are talking about maritime trade. We are talking about connectivity between West Bengal and the Northeast. We are talking about turning that whole area into an economic zone, which will, after all, who will, you know, the great thing about our economics is that it benefits governments far less than it benefits the people.
Yes.
And that really is what we are hoping all the time. You know, history is a very long, you know, history works, walks very softly. History walks very slowly. But we have, when it moves maybe at the pace of an elephant, but also with the power of an elephant. Right? Look what we have achieved through peace between India and Bangladesh. And if there is, hopefully, some sense on all sides, we can do it also with Pakistan. But one thing that we cannot happen, it will not happen if there is violence. Violence today is unacceptable as a means to a solution by anywhere in the civilized world. It's not just in our subcontinent, anywhere in the civilized world. And that is why against terrorism, people forget all other considerations and stand by those who have been the victims of this existential terror that we have seen in the last 6 years. So today, as always, you know, we have an opportunity, and I really cannot say whether the, you know, we will have the capacity, the intellectual as well as the, you know, emotional resources to make use of this opportunity, I can't say. But if we do, then new horizons begin to open up, you know. Sorry, at one point, I had said that, you know, Europe thinks of the Berlin Wall as this great metaphor for separation. Today, unfortunately, into our West, the whole of Pakistan has become a wall between us and Afghanistan, between us and Central Asia. We can't do things that we take for granted, which is trade, human rights. Today, in order to do trade with Pakistan, we have to have air corridors and go around, think of going around by the sea and so on and so forth. This is a colossal waste of resources. A colossal economic, you know, self-inflicted wounds. And, you know, we are not rich nations, face it. We have so much to do, you know, in terms of helping our people get what they truly did get. What did we win freedom for? We didn't win freedom in order to institutionalize war. We won freedom for the benefit of the people. Let's get on with it.
Exactly. Professor Ahmed, then, you know, since we are talking about economics, interestingly, General Bajwa also used the term geoeconomics. And one would have hoped that maybe that would be the factor to sort of move past some of these issues. But are we reaching that stage right now? Do you think some of these other issues can probably become get the momentum going before the thorny aspects of the Indo-Pak relations are addressed? Because, you know, at the end, economics itself is the single biggest driving factor, more so given the economic crisis that Pakistan is facing at a more acute level, but the world is facing after coronavirus.
If you ever get hold of my book, Pakistan, the Garrison State, in the conclusions, I say that for all these years, Pakistan has used its geostrategic advantage to wage wars or to arm itself. It's time now to use that geostrategic advantage to gain economic benefits, exactly as Akbar Sahib is saying, because Indian trade, in order to go to Central Europe, Central Asia, and so on, if facilitated by Pakistan, it is zero investment of Pakistan and 100% profit in the terms of levies and other charges. And then there one can argue that we want joint ventures so that if you trade through us, come and be partners with us and let's trade together. I mean, all these things, I go, when I travel to Pakistan, the business community is willing to do it. They have looked at the pros and cons and they find that there are greater benefits accruing to them, even when their own industry is very poorly developed. Well, I'm talking for about 10 years ago. India has gone ahead far more now. So industrially, you are much better. Economically, financially, you are much more sound. Pakistan is in a very bad shape. So in Pakistan's rational best interest, it is good to have trade with India. I often say that Pakistan is frozen into an ideological mindset. It must undo that. This is the age of trade. China and India have just had a skirmish and so on, but their trade continues. Pakistan-India trade is abysmal. Let me explain with a bit of theory. You know, when a region works together, there are two factors which are to be considered. One is the Hobbesian idea of a threat. And the other is the Locke-in idea of a benefit. The problem is that India and Pakistan do not see a shared threat either from China or from some other force. They see each other as a threat to their security. This must come to an end. This, the Locke-in factor that there is benefit accruing to both sides cannot be questioned because this is so clear. I remember Imran Khan when in 2004, when he was not in government, he was arranging a cancer hospital in Karachi. And he invited Amir Khan, the Indian actor, to collect money. And I remember Imran Khan saying that we should have trade with India because one of the medicines, a pill they use for cancer treatment, if they buy it from the West, it costs rupees 161. The same pill from India costs 52 rupees. So here was a man who, when out of power, was speaking sanity. Once in power, let me now be very self-critical. This is a tradition from the time of Jinnah. Always to create suspicion that the Hindus want to undo Muslims, annihilate Islam. I've given this all in my book, Jinnah, His Successes, Failures, and Role in History. So the two, annihilation of Islam and obliteration of Muslims, these were the two slogans he used. Why Muslims need a Pakistan. Once Pakistan came into being, this old habit then added another thing, that India wants to undo us. And I have said, if this were true, how come all the four wars you have launched on India? So all this is basically flawed even in basic reasoning. And evidence-wise, it flies in the face of the Pakistani behavior or conduct during these years. So,
yes.
Well, let me say one thing. What I regret is, and since Akbar Saab is here, I want to bring to his notice that please tell your RSS, you know, cadres, you know, when I am interviewed and all, they write such, if you disagree a little or you are a bit critical of Mr. Modi or whatever, they use abusive language. They insult you, insult me all the time. And this is done in an organized manner, because even in India, the Hindu mind has been captured by this ideological fixation with Muslims somehow wanting to undo India. You know, India has developed a minority complex when it is a huge minority. And in Pakistan, where we are 96%, we also have a minority complex, and we go around attacking Christians and MDs. And this is all proto-fascism going on. India was the good big brother. It's now become as nasty as Pakistan has always been. Like POK, why do you say POK? That is Pakistan's Kashmir. You want your Kashmir, you have integrated it. Go ahead with it. Have the courage to say it. This is the line of control. We keep ours, you keep yours. So if you keep on asking for or threatening us to take the Pakistani Azad Kashmir, how do you expect the Pakistan government to give up its claims on the Indian Kashmir? Somebody has to have the courage to speak out the truth that this is what we want. This is the line of control. It should become the international border. We have no claims on Pakistani Kashmir. And Pakistan can then be persuaded to say we can do nothing about Kashmir. That's
okay.
All.
The journalist in me is very happy that the conversation is getting spicier. But, you know, Mr. Akbar, the fact is that these two issues have been raised. I mean, Mr. Imran Khan's rant is not taken seriously by a lot of people, even his own government for that matter. But the perception or the narrative and the optics that have been built around the present dispensation, do you think there is a way that it's having a larger impact? Or do you think that's just the kind of rant that you've been seeing in only several quarters?
Dr. Saab, my experience or my reading in my books, whether it was Pakistan, Tinderbox, the Past and Future of Pakistan, or my latest book is Gandhi's Hinduism, the Challenge of Jinnah's Islam. The language tends to follow a decision. Hmm. Decisions don't follow a language.
Right.
So, jab hoga, tab dekhenge. In the meantime, the real thing to do is to work towards getting sufficient momentum behind what I would call a process.
Okay.
Number two, I don't know, Professor Saab, when was the last time you visited my country or not? I, you know, I cannot, no country, no one can take, you know, there are always be people on the margins and so on and so forth. And I think even if you come here, you must meet some of the people who actually are in the organization that you mentioned and speak to them and see what they say and see what they feel. Dialogue must be open to them. But I'll tell you something very firmly about my country, my India. My India, if you come to Delhi, the first thing I would like you to do, and like to take you, like to take anyone, is to the Old Delhi, where every morning begins with the azan, followed closely by the bells of the Hanuman temple, followed closely by the part of the Gurdwara Sahib, and followed at Sundays by church bells. It is rings that the heart and soul of India rings with the equality of every faith. I am proud to be a Muslim in my country. And I am proud to say what I said, and that you know has existed long before Gandhiji and would exist, inshallah, long after we are all gone. That is my India. But to come to now the point, Gauri, that you know you were making about taking things forward and how do we get beyond it. I sometimes, you know, the gap between good intentions and the ability to actually achieve them is always one of the greatest challenges of anyone being in power. And that is true. That was true, I think, when Nixon wanted to come to terms with Vietnam, when Nixon wanted to come to terms with China, and so on. I mean, this is not a new phenomenon or a, you know, a subcontinental phenomenon. It's a phenomenon everywhere. But the leap that is required requires, you know, both a leap of ability and of imagination. I don't think that we could have gone as far as we have gone. Even over the last few weeks, you know, what are we talking about? We have been talking only of the last few weeks when some incipient signs of something happening suddenly seemed to blossom in the air. We don't know how substantive it was, how substantial it was, right? But there was clearly some effort being made somewhere, right? There are, certainly I can say this for certain, that there are very good leadership on our side, which wants to end and put this behind. I refer to you once again that it was Prime Minister Modi's initiative in 2014, which brought the SAARC leaders and President Nawaz Sharif or Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif to Delhi. Then it was he who took the initiative of stopping by in Lahore and so on. I just hope, and let me just say this very clearly, that if we do not have any recurrence of terrorism, if there is no major incident or any incident of terrorism, then we will be able to try and find a route map out of this fog. It is a fog. It's a fog which has taken 70 years to build. It is a fog which has seen a great amount of lightning strike almost repeatedly in the same place. It's a myth that lightning doesn't strike in the same place. It keeps striking in the same place. And we will. It's a very difficult task. It's not easy. But because it is difficult, it doesn't mean that we should not try. But as I said, the only thing that can wreck it is the recurrence of violence, recurrence of terrorism. I think let's give the one thing that this process needs, time.
Right.
Needs time, it needs patience, it needs at every step, somebody will say this and somebody will say that. But if you have a route map, then and if we have enough goodwill, perhaps we shall see yet again if this works or not.
Professor Ahmed, do we have time? And I ask you this for two reasons, sir. One is there are some reports that seem to indicate that this year in July, there will be some efforts to sort of integrate Gilgit as well as POK as provinces. That could happen is what some reports seem to indicate. And there are some reports that also say that if there is a UN team that comes in Afghanistan, India will be a partner and part of it, something that Pakistan doesn't want, and in return would probably be willing to make some headway on its relations with India. Keeping these two aspects in mind, do we have that kind of time? Do we have that kind of patience and a long-term vision that the something as sensitive as the India-Pak peace process needs?
Well, what you meant was Pakistan, Azad Kashmir should become a regular part of Pakistan as a province. I have written
that, that's what some reports are indicating. Yes.
Yeah. You called it POK. I call it Pakistan Azad Kashmir. That's the difference. Okay.
Right. Yes.
So I'm saying that if Pakistan were to integrate it and make it another province, you know, we have four, it becomes the fifth.
Yes.
Very good. Very good. This is exactly what I have been writing. So it's not here that you invite me on this prestigious discussion with a senior member of the BJP that I'm saying this. I've had this published in Pakistan.
Right. No, sir. What I meant was, if something like this happens and there's a reaction from India, then are we on the same path? That's what I was saying.
Yes. Well, if there's a reaction from India, then it's too bad. Somebody has to call the bluff. You can't get our Kashmir and we can't get Kashmir, which is with you. So who has the courage to accept it? That's what I'm saying. So if India starts, creating a tempo for war and all, then it's back to square one and we are ready for it. Both are nuclear powers. Only insane people will go to war. What they will do is they will not let trade flourish. They will not let people meet. So is it worth doing it? Let Pakistan integrate Azad Kashmir and Gilgit and whatever it is. They have already given portions to China. What can you do about it? Can you go to war with China and liberate it? You can't. You can't even get the Kashmir which we have now. That's the way history has decided. And that's the way it should be. Realistically, there should have been no partition, but there is a partition and there are two nations now. You know, let me tell you that the first time I came to India was in 1979. And I was staying in a hotel. It was afternoon. And I saw a soldier praying in the mosque. And I was taken aback. Till then, I didn't realize that in India, there are mosques and an Indian soldier can be a Muslim. So what Akbar Sahab has claimed is very true about India. And that is why I have always believed that without a partition, all of us would have done much better. But now there is a partition and there are two nations. And we have tried war. We have tried to play the zero-sum games in international forums. And everybody looks at us and says, what's your problem? You are poverty-ridden. Your people don't have enough education, enough clean water. So nobody takes us seriously, especially Pakistan, because Pakistan has wrecked its own cases. How can you have an Indian prime minister coming and signing this Lahore Accord and then you do Kargil? And of course, when Mr. Modi came to this wedding sort of ceremony, the next day they did Pathankot. Pakistan has been doing it. It's I call it nihilism. Nihilism means self-destruction. The problem with Pakistan is it is 220 million people. It's a nuclear armed power. Nobody in the world on earth wants Pakistan to disintegrate. Imagine, and I hope it never happens, Pakistan does disintegrate. Let's say 5 million Punjabis move into the Indian Kashmir. Will you accept them? Let's say 5 million Pakistanis come to Europe. The whole welfare system will collapse. The whole world wants Pakistan to stay put. Nobody wants to undo Pakistan except the Pakistani myopic elite, which is fixated on India. India hating doesn't give us any positive feelings. You can't hate people and feel good. But I tell you, whenever I've met Hindu families and Sikh families who have been to Pakistan and they've been to Lahore and other places, people take them home, say, Panji, tusi aa gaye ho, tusi jana hi nahi. They go to shops, people don't charge them. The rickshaw driver also doesn't charge them. So the common people are not full of all this hatred. This is elite done and through the educational process. The common man in India and Pakistan is the same. They carry the wisdom of the Sufis. They carry the wisdom of the gurus. They carry the wisdom of the sons. It's all in their way of thinking and behaving. We have narrow-minded elites, especially in Pakistan. I do have objections to where the BJP government conducts itself. When it was Nehru and the rest, they were gentlemen, they were good people. Now, I'm not convinced about that because of so many things which have happened in the recent times. But then I can have an opinion about your country. I still think Narendra Modi is the prime minister elected by the people of India, and he has the right to negotiate whatever deal he may for with Pakistan. Basically, it is Pakistan to accept the facts that we gain more than anyone else if we establish peace with India. About Afghanistan and all, I don't know. I mean, I don't like speculating. I'm not a journalist. I can only talk about those things where I'm 110% sure that what I say, I mean it. Okay. And I can predict to you, you will never get our Kashmir. We will never get your Kashmir. The sooner we accept it, there is a solution. But let's start the process, as M.G. Akbar Saab says. I totally agree with him.
As I wrap this, Mr. Akbar, let me then ask you a final question. There's so much that has been talked about, you know, how probably the time is never right when it comes to India-Pakistan. But, you know, Prime Minister Modi has enough and more political capital. If anything, he is nothing like some of the previous prime ministers. He may never say that I'm going to leave this to the wisdom of the next generation or the one after that. And he may try and solve this once and for all. What do you think could be the first baby steps? Because there's no point talking about a big grand vision unless we identify maybe the first or the second steps in this entire conundrum, so to say.
Well, peace, you know, efforts between India and Pakistan, you know, are tragically, they have what you may call baby cycles. You know, one cycle ends and you go back to being a baby. Baby steps are toddler steps. Toddler steps are uncertain steps, right? And we have to understand that they are also vulnerable steps. So the best way to take forward baby steps is in silence, is in, you know, the confabulations that do not get afflicted by my old profession and your current one, which is journalism, particularly the journalism of hysteria, which unfortunately seems to afflict audiovisual media more than it did the sober pages of newsprint. There is a lot, really, that can be, particularly, as I said, when a baby is taking steps, it's very easy to make the child stumble, to make the child fall, to make the child nervous about continuing walking. Mm-hmm. So the term that you may have used inadvertently turns out to be a fairly accurate description of what we are doing now. And I'm always now, I get extremely worried when news appears, because news seems to always to become harmful to the process. And I just hope, and I'm sure our Aziz Professor Ahmed will also agree, we just hope that the less we may know of anything positive, the better it might be for positivity to become reality.
I like that wisdom. Maybe that's the way forward. Not too much in the public, but privately, or, you know, back channel if they can agree. I mean, this they will decide the future of the subcontinent. The people have not voted for this sort of confrontation. They never voted for, anyhow, let's, I don't want to go into the partition and all. I mean, right. Who would have voted for the partition of Punjab if the peasant were told that you'll have to run for your life? The peasant would die, then give up his land.
Right, right.
So the whole process through which this was done was evil, I would say. That's my finding in the book on the partition of Punjab.
And do please remember, one of the things I've stressed very heavily in my book on a similar subject is that the electorate was never more than 10%.
Yes, 11, 10%.
The people of the land did not vote for it. The elites of the land voted for it.
Exactly.
The landlords.
100%. This is also my argument. 11% people had the right to vote. And who were those people who were either property owners or had an education? My grandfather had the right to vote. I mean, in our sort of tabar, you know, because he had some land and so on. But that's all. How can you divide a whole subcontinent on the voting of 11% of the population? And especially on the Punjab, had the peasant been given this information that if you vote for so-so, you will have to run for your life, I tell you, nobody would have done it. The peasant is tied to the land. So all this was done by the British in great haste. And if you read my book, Jinnah, his successes, failures, and role in history, especially Apna Akbar Bhai, if you do it, and I hope you do, you will find that you and I have very similar observations and we reach more or less the same conclusions. Yeah,
I will. I'll get it immediately. Yeah. Good old Amazon is still alive.
That's correct.
Absolutely. On that note, I must thank both of you for joining me in this very refreshing conversation, which stayed away from the rant and the rabidness that has sort of taken over discussions around a very contentious issue and robbed it of the potential to be able to identify a solution. Both panelists, both speakers today said that and hope that maybe those back channel lines of communication, which a lot of people think have been very alive and robust since 2018, may just be able to find that elusive answer that the entire subcontinent is looking for, which is that peace formula. As I said, Prime Minister Modi is unlikely to leave this to the next generations. He is likely to possibly hunt for that solution. The sooner we do, the better it is for the entire subcontinent. Thank you so much for watching this very special conversation that USI put together.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you very much.